This program is proudly brought to you by DHMT Accounting Limited.
This is your favorite football show where we bring Zimbabwe football legends to come here and tell us his story, the shenanigans and interesting things that happened during his career. This show brought to you by DHMT Accounting Limited, all the way in the United Kingdom. For all your accounting needs, accounting problems, just look for them in the United Kingdom and your problems are solved. Today we've got an interesting guest and trading legend here. His name is Carlos Max. They call him Rewa, but I call him simply Kali.
Kali,
hi, always.
Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
Yes, Kali, it's very exciting and interesting to have you on the show. Very, very interesting indeed, because we know you have had a colorful career, but it all started with Acadia United, isn't it?
Yes, it did. I went through the ranks of Acadia United junior football. Acadia United back then had a very, very organized junior football, which started in under 14s, under 16s, under 18s.
And you started from the under 14s?
And I started from the under 14s.
Went to the under 16s?
Went to under 16s.
At what age did you get into the Premier Soccer League? No, it was not Premier Soccer League, it was the Super League.
Yes, I got in just at about the age 20 or so, obviously spending a couple of seasons in the reserve team. Mm. You know, those days reserve team football was as well, you know, well organized.
Yes.
For every Super League game, they will always have return game.
Yes. One o'clock.
Yes. Yes, that's when I got in, just after finishing the under 18s. I spent about a year or two in the reserve team. Prior to getting to the first team, I also wanted to join Rhinos that just been formed.
Why did you want to go and join?
Because I wasn't happy that I wasn't getting into KDS. You know, Rhino's been a new team. I thought, you know, I'll get a chance there. But I had already signed for Acadia. Those days we used to get what we call retainer signing.
I was retained
For $25. So Rhinos actually did want me, but Acadia stood their ground, and it took me a whole season fighting them, failing to get a clearance from them. So I ended up going back to Acadia.
So do you think maybe it's the reason why they ended up giving you a place to start? In Acadia, you put pressure.
Yes, it definitely is.
If you don't play me, I want to leave.
Yes, it definitely is. You know, I went through lots of meetings at the Zifa House with, you know, the chefs of Rhinos. Yes, we used to go to Zifa House to try and get my clearance.
Yes.
And I went with the chefs of Rhinos, you know, to try and discuss with the Zifa chairman and the Cage United bosses that, hey, you know, listen, the guy needs to play, he hasn't played for you, so let him go. And they stood by the ground, they said, no way, he's our player, and we're not letting him go.
But Rhinos were in the first division or in the Super League at that time?
In the first division.
In the first division at that time?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, interesting story that is. So what year did you eventually get into the Acadia first team?
Yeah, well, obviously Rhinos was formed in 1983 when they won promotion. When they won promotion, Acadia gave me the option to say, come try. If you fail to make the first team, we'll give you a clearance, no problem.
Now it was now tight now, because Rhinos had already bought so many players, and they now the upper hand.
Yes, you see, and I think that's what also improved my football attitude and all, because I was training daily with people like Sticks and Teasers, Stanley Duduma, you know, Simon Mugabe, Mids Dana, you know, Jerry. I was with Japan Porutz and all those guys. I was the young boy there, but those guys, you know, like, never treated me like one of them, you know, at Rhinos. And Rhinos was the only team training during the day. So, you know, I learned a lot from them, the Rhinos. So when I went to Acadia now, I had a different attitude altogether of playing football. And so, but in a pre-season, I was in the first team.
Then it all started. When I first saw you play football, it was at Acadia United. And you were not a defender. A lot of people in Zimbabwe know you as a defender. Yeah. What were you doing up front? I think you were number 10 or something.
Yes.
In the Rothman Cup final against Dynamos at Rufaro Stadium, I think.
Yes, that's right.
Yes. What were you doing up front?
what happened in, during pre-season training, on the first day we went for a pre-season match, I was actually in the reserve team at 1 o'clock, played right back. And then the team was actually short for the pre-season, so they put me on the bench for the first team after playing for the reserve team.
Okay.
And then because where we were short off for the injuries was up front. So when they put me on, as left wing. Ever since then, I never looked back that season.
Left wing?
Left
wing. But you don't use left, do you?
Everybody in Zimbabwe thinks I'm a left footer.
I know yes, you're not a left footer. Yeah, that's why I was saying that when I first saw you, I saw you playing up front. I'm like, but a lot of people, a lot of Zimbabweans actually know you as a defender. So guys, you know that Carlos Mack started his career up front.
Yes, I played
up front. Reserve side in defense, first team up front. Yes.
The following week, we went to Bulawayo. We played Saints in the quarterfinals of the PHE Rose Bowl.
Yes.
We beat Saints 1-0. The following week, we played Caps, semifinals. I was still playing left wing. We beat them 6-3. I scored 2 goals.
Kali.
That was on all the way for me now.
Yeah, you're telling us, you know, with a smile. I can see your smile when you're talking about Acadia. Yeah. Tell us about some of the teammates at Acadia.
I'm playing there. I was obviously playing with, I was the younger guy. Charlie Jones was there, and we were playing with like
Carlos Sanchez,
Carbasco, or there was Mabruka.
Is it you who gave him the nickname?
No, he already had the name. I think he got it from Caps, because he had come back from Caps.
Oh, he had come back from Caps.
Yeah. There was players like Bethel Salas, there was Mike Abrams, there was Majid Dana, there was some David Zulu, and they were all there.
Strong.
Yeah, strong team. Joey Antipas was there. Joey Antipas was the right back.
Yes.
So that was why there was the option of me not playing right back. He was the senior guy there. So, Majid Dana, Reg Payne, you know, all really like senior.
Those names, you know, I was growing up, you know, when I was growing up, I used to have a football book. So I remember those cuttings, those names. Acadia had brilliant players at that time. Yeah. So you were actually part of a brilliant.
Yes.
Wasn't that like a golden generation for Acadia?
It was. It actually was. Although there were some players prior to that, you know, the ones that won the Castle Cup and the league in the early, late 70s, 78 and all. You know, like Herman Hendricks and company and Eddie Layton and, you know, Stuart Gilbert. Those were, you know, those were golden years for Acadia as well. So this was just sort of like a new era, you know, bringing it back from, because it lost its prestige for a couple of years. So by that time now, we had players, Anthony Kambani, you know, Kivu Nyauma, Danny Jumbo. It was a, you know, well-organized team.
Acadia was a community team, you know. Yeah. It was different from, we'll talk about it later when you move. But Acadia was a community team and everything was around Acadia Sports Club, Danny Bismarck. How did it feel to actually play in a community in front of the fans of, like, people that you grew up with?
I think that's what made playing for Acadia so special, because, you know, the people that came, they cheered you up and all, they knew about you, they knew where you came from, you know, and, you know, when you were a young man like that and they see you doing well, they actually, you know, even gave you more courage to, you know, go forward. When you're walking in the streets of Acadia, you know, they'll, you know, comment you and, you know, tell you to keep pushing, and that was a good thing about it. You know, after the games, you were always at Acadia Community Center. Even after training, you know, the community was always there, you know, there was always action at Acadia Sports Club. So that was one of the good things, is it made it a family unit, you know, even outside of football, players and all, because we're from the same community, we did a lot of things together, you know, we have parties together, off-season, we brang at each other's houses.
Parties, who was the party animal there?
All of them.
All of them were party animals.
Well, all, there's very few, well, I would say, I mean, not that it was bad, but very few that were non-drinking players, you know, outside of football. So, you know, outside of football, like when we won the Chibuku Cup, you know, we partied for 3 days after that. They were either by Charlie's house or by Joey's house or, you know, somebody's house, you know.
But then you left Acadia with all these nice things at Acadia. Why did you move from your community team to Caps United?
Unfortunately, at the time, Acadia were just about surviving. They had lost sponsorship, you know, were surviving on individuals. So the team wasn't thriving in the way it should have. It was starting to also lose the community support, you know, because they weren't doing as well as they should be doing. And so my career seemed to have got at a standstill at Acadia. And I thought by then moving, I would progress. Obviously, we as footballers, we look to do better. You look to win things. You look to play the national team. The biggest, you know, achievement of all is obviously playing for the national team. And I felt with Acadia, you know, it wouldn't happen. You know, I'd only once previously been called for the national team, while at Acadia, and it was to open the National Sports Stadium. This was a B team select, because the normal first team 11 were playing
official game on the Sunday, and we did the opening on the Saturday.
Yeah, I remember that match. Also, yeah. Prenam Siska spoke about that match when he came on the show the other day. Mm. But then you moved to Caps United. Mm. Who made it happen? Who made it happen for you to move?
Well, because I knew some of the Caps players individually, for the mere fact that my sister was an adamant and a diehard Caps supporter. And a lot of the guys used to, you know, come to her place and after, during the week or on after games, you know, and just socialize. And especially one of the guys that used to come there was the official, which was Julius Chifokoyo.
Yes.
You know, and he was the, besides the HR manager at Caps, he was the secretary general at
Caps United.
Caps United.
Yes.
Yeah. So it was easy just to, you know, get the move. And he, being the professional he was, he made it simple for me to leave Caps, to join Caps.
So, Carlos Marx was now at Caps United. We were going to take that up when we come back from the break. But for now, guys, we're just going to go for a break. Don't move away. Exciting stories from Carlos Marx. He is now at Caps United. We're going to be talking about it after the break. Don't move away. We'll be back after the break.
Here comes the business lady.
She always has a chauffeur.
Hey Stella, I've been waiting for you. What have you been up to?
Sorry girls, I've just been to DHMT accounting. They've finished doing my tax returns and account submissions all done and dusted. They are so efficient.
DHMT Accounting Limited, for all your UK accounting and HMRC requirements.
Welcome back. In touch with a legend, we've got Carlos Marx in the house. Carly, you're now at Caps United, and you were playing as a defender, you're playing as a striker at Arcadia, you're playing in opposite. Which position now at Caps United? What position did they sign you for?
Well, even though they had Kuzinai Terabinga there playing at right back, and he was doing well at the time.
Yes.
I was a natural right back. I just spent the last 3-4 seasons playing right back for Arcadia. Playing well. I just won the Cage United Soccer Star of the Year.
The year
I left them. So I looked to go and play at right back for Caps because it's where I was comfortable and where I know I would progress.
So you pushed Kuzi Zaringa out of the team?
Yes, they ended up pushing Kuzi to left back.
But you were playing left wing at Arcadia. And wasn't it like natural for them to just drop you down to left back? Why did they switch you to right back and when they knew that you could also play on?
Well, like I said, I just come out 4 seasons after that, even although I only spent 1 season in the left wing.
Okay.
I just come out 4 seasons of at playing right back for Arcadia. So they thought that was obviously the natural position for me to play.
So you joined Caps United, the Cup Kings. Tell us about the Cup winning games at Caps United.
Yeah, you know, the Caps United had inspiring seniors there at Caps, and me being not only just a newcomer, but of an outsider. But you know, I befriended a lot of the senior guys. It wasn't even a while when I started working at Caps. So we used to spend a lot of time during working hours together. People like Joel Shambo, Friday Piri, that time Kleber Muzua was there. You know, Paddington Zanji was there, and Sheikh Mantaul. Most importantly, Sheikh Mantaul was there.
Why most important?
Because he was, you know, for the younger players, you know, he really know how to deal with them and how to, you know, direct them in the correct way. Most of the players at Caps worked at Caps, so we spent all our lunch hours. You know, there was a big
together,
canteen. There's a big canteen at the back.
So we
used to go to the canteen, play table tennis, sit and have lunch, and you know, and we talked about games, talked about, you know, just general life in general. So the good thing about Caps is, even though it wasn't a community team, I don't think.
But any, players themselves were a community.
I don't think any players were not friends with everybody. Was very friendly with everybody at Caps United.
And then you were coming from a community team. You used to go party at the Arcadia Sports Club with the players. Did that also happen at Caps United, the parties?
Well, like I said, it's what footballers do normally, you know, after games.
This is what we want to hear. Okay,
you know,
talking.
It's what we do after games, you know. We had special places where we went to after games, like Saturday, Sunday after game. Sunday, you know, like Caps had the place where they went. You know, we used to call it TK, you know, Terrascan Hotel.
Terrascan,
we used to have a little pub in there. And then, like Mondays, we used to have a place called Brett's.
Okay,
and at that time I think there were 7 teams in Harare: Rhinos, Black Aces, Arcadia, Dynamos, Caps. It must have been about 7,
yeah.
And all the senior players On Monday at 5 o'clock would be at Brett's nightclub. Well, it wasn't a nightclub during the week. So, yeah. But we just used to gather there, you know, have a
from
few
different
drinks.
Clubs.
From different clubs. Yes.
That was good.
You know, and we used to sit and talk, and you know, if Caps played against Aces, you will find we used to like tease one another and say, you know, how we watched you, and now, you know, the goal I scored, and you know the that's mistakes you make. And so it used to be very exciting, you know. And it used to be like almost throughout the season, every Monday, you know, all the players came, you know, with Rhinos players, Caps players, Dynamos players, you know, at least they have to spend an hour, 2 hours.
You know my next question. You know my next question. Yeah. Who were the naughty boys there? Yeah. Who were the naughty boys?
There's a list of them, huh? You know, it's a long time to remember the things it did, but you know, just the conversations we had. There were mad guys like Archibald Chimwetanda. You know, there was mad guys.
Yes, like, what did he used to do there? We heard what he used to do in the changing room. What he used to do in the pub. What did he used to do?
We had bad guys like Marunga and, some other, you know, funny guys like Sticks and them. And, you know, just about the jokes and the things we used to say and stuff like that. You know,
and of the jokes?
Archiford, one time he joined, Acadia, and he went to stay with Brian Harry, and so he went, left Mbare there, and he went to stay in the northern suburbs, you see. So when I was sitting there, and he was talking to Anna Gift and them, and stuff like that, and, you know, and he says, you guys, where I stay now? My northern suburbs, you know, when I get up in the morning, I don't hear whoa, 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 whoa. I hear birds going, tee, 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 tee. That's how quiet the summer
is.
The birds like, well, tee, tee, tee. But whoa, 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 whoa. Noise from 8 o'clock in the morning. So when I jump in the bath, you know, I open the tap, I don't know where the water is coming from. Yeah, I'm not doing this.
I'm like, all the time.
Yeah, you know, I'm relaxed, you know, I'm living a new life. And you like teasing one another about, you know, yes, yeah. But it was all good, you know, all in good faith, yeah.
All in good faith. I like the idea of all the players from different clubs actually coming together and actually having drinks. We don't see that often with the youngsters of today, these days. Yeah. But Caps United, tell us more about Caps United. Yeah. What can you tell us about the highlights of your career at Caps United?
Well, there's so many of them, you know. I think for 3 seasons in a row,
we have got time. Yes. Tell us all of them.
For 3 seasons in a row, I always argue people about the names of it, whether it's called Castle Cup or the Zifa Netball Cup or just the Netball Cup.
Yeah, it used to change names.
I think 2-3 seasons in a row, we were in the finals. I think we only won it once, you know, and we lost to Dynamos, lost to Tengenda, you know, we even lost to. Tengena is the team I meant to mention. And, you know, I think I've won every single cup that was played in Zimbabwe as Caps player, from the BAT to the Chibok Cup to the Rothmans Cup. To Heroes Trophy, to Independence Trophy, to Africa, the Zipper Cups, Africa Day Trophies. Yeah, I've actually won all of them, besides being the runners-up on different occasions, but I've won every single trophy in Zimbabwe with Caps United.
And the saddest moment at Caps United, any disappointing moments, what you can call the most disappointing moments at Caps United, that, you know, at this moment, you know, it was really, really sad, we got disappointed.
One game where I think cost us the league, and actually one of the mistakes I made, I was playing centre for Caps at Gwanzura Stadium, and we were playing Aces, and Aces were fighting for the league at the time as well, and we ended up losing to them 2-1, and I played centre half, and I allowed the ball to bounce, and by that bouncing, Percy Marcy managed to get the better of me and scored the winner. And because we gave the points to Aces, they ended up winning that league that season.
And your most memorable match, just one that you can say, when I think about this match, I was Kali.
Yeah, many. My most memorable match was, before I go there, there was the other disappointment I had with Caps, against Dynamos at Rufaro Stadium. Africa Day semi-final, and I was playing left back. Steven Jikodi was playing right back.
Now you back to left back now, I suggested that.
I was actually playing left back that day. Steven Jikodi was playing right back.
Oh, okay, Steven Jikodi had now come in because Kuzi had left.
Yeah, Kuzi had now already left and was playing with Chapungo there. But, and Mugo Sugar, where Robbie was playing obviously on the left wing.
For Dynamos,
you know, he kept you know, like bullying Stephen, because Stephen was a new player, and you know, he kept, you know, fouling Stephen and all. And I walked across the pitch, you know, and I said to, and I spoke to Sugar and said, you know, stop picking on the youngster. Why don't you come by my side and, you know, I'll teach you about football properly. And I don't know what the assistant had me saying. So he called the referee and said, Carlos is using bad language on thing. And the referee came straight and gave me a red card.
Red card?
Yeah.
Just for that?
Just for that.
But he didn't even hear what you were saying?
He didn't hear. And the referee said, you piece of language. And that time we were winning 1-0. I was given a red card. There was still about 20.
You think the referee was a Dynamos fan?
Yeah, but this referee was the third time he's giving me a red card. I've only been given 3 red cards in my career, and they all came from the same referee.
Same referee?
Same referee.
Okay, we want to know the name. Tell us, who is this referee?
I think he must be late now, Gerald Quartizo.
Gerald Quartizo.
Yeah.
You were very unfortunate with Gerald Quartizo. Yeah. So that was the highlight, the saddest moment. Point. So we were asking about the highest moment, the game that you can actually tell us that, you know what, this is my most memorable match at Caps United.
Well, it was against Highlanders in the Independence Cup. I was now playing midfield. I was the D-Link there.
Yes. D-Link?
Yes.
At Caps?
At Caps. We beat them 1-0 to win the final. And I had a very, very thrilling game. I was man of the match. And the supporters were so happy with me. I never went walked to the dressing room.
Yeah.
They carried me. About 4,000 supporters came onto the field and carried me across to the...
Is that when they called you Mreo?
I think that was in maybe a season or two when they already started the Mreo.
When you joined?
Yeah. My first season at Caps wasn't as good as it should have been.
Yeah.
Because the big problem I had was, again, playing too many positions. At Caps, in the first season, I played every position except goalkeeper. I played right back. I played center half, I played left back, I played D-Link, I played attacking link, I turned striker with Friday.
So you can call yourself a utility player?
Yeah, so yes, obviously I think we can do that.
Then you moved?
Yeah. Then after the season, because it was actually hindering me in being comfortable where I want to play, I actually went to coach Freddie, who was very approachable. I said, if I can't play right back, I better not play because I'm not, you know, getting up to my standard of football. And within 3 months of the season, I was called up for the national team.
Then,
and right back.
Then you moved to Dynamos. When did you move to Dynamos?
Well, Dynamos was way after my career, which was almost after 7 years of playing for Caps.
After 7 years of playing for Caps. Okay, just hold that thought. Guys, we're just going to go for a break. When we come back, we want to hear how Kali ended up playing for Dynamos. Yeah. Don't move away. We'll be back after the break.
Here comes the business lady.
She always had a chauffeur.
Hey Stella, I've been waiting for you. What have you been up to?
Sorry girls, I've just been to DHMT accounting. They've finished doing my tax returns and account submissions all done and dusted. They are so efficient.
DHMT Accounting Limited, for all your UK accounting and HMRC requirements.
Welcome back, In Touch with a Legend. We have got Kali, Carlos Max in the house. Kali, you played for Caps United for all of 7 years, then you decided to move. Why did you leave Caps United, and especially why did you move to the bitter rivals, Dynamos?
Well, it's actually a bit of a story. It wasn't just a plan. After 7 years of playing for Caps, I actually wanted to, I was coming obviously closely to the end of my career, so I wanted to sort of like help my community team, my childhood team, which was Acadia.
Yeah.
They had been in D1 for the last 7 years as well.
Yeah.
And they were on the verge of promotion back to the Super League. So they asked me, you know, if I could come and assist them and organize with Caps, and give Caps even put me on loan. It was already halfway of the 94 season. So it was a plan to go and help Acadia get back into the Super League. And I barely played 3 games, and I got taught the first division way of life with a crude tackle. And that was it. I was, my knee was damaged. Damaged my anterior ligaments, damaged my lateral ligaments. I was in plaster for 3 months and, you know, cast for some other gadgets for another 3 months. So that all of the season I ended out. once I managed to get a little bit back fit to training, obviously Acadia never made the promotion.
The promotion, yes.
And I think you had also just joined Caps then, because Stephen Kwashi was there now.
Caps. 96, yeah, okay.
Yes. No, 95.
95, yes.
Yeah. Stephen Kwashi was there now.
It was Stephen Kwashi. We joined later. It was Lloyd and Frank Nyamkota. We joined first in 95. Yeah.
Okay. And I still was wearing a big knee guard, and I was running with a bit of a lump. And Steve said to me, "I know what, we don't want to waste your time. Looks like you're not going to, you know."
Yeah.
We're also looking at the younger generation now, and you know, you don't seem to be, you know, up to standard with your fitness and all that there. So, you know, besides Acadia, I had written me off, now Caps writing me off. And I worked hard a little bit. I spent 2 months just doing my personal training and all that there. And after getting, I think, back to a better level of fitness, Sunday said to me, because Sunday was obviously new me, he had coached the Caps before.
Mm-hmm.
He was with us at the gym team, with Fabish. So,
yes.
You know, he was always in touch with me and, you know, what I was capable of. And he said, "Well, then why don't you just come play for us?" And I went and joined Dynamos, just because of the fact that Sunday was willing to give me a chance.
So you joined Dynamos. Just quickly, before we get into the national team, you spoke about Sunday Marimo, having known you from the national team. We just want to know the highlights of your career at Dynamos. Any highs that you can tell us about?
Yes, I mean, Dynamos, my first good thing that is, I either played right back or center half. I played, you know, Sunday always liked the 3-5-2 system.
Yeah.
So, you know, I always partners with either Katano or what's his name, Francis Shonai. At the time, he was still there, and we had a good, you know, good combination going. I think my first six games of playing at centre half for Dynamos, we never conceded a goal, you know. And obviously, the highlight was I'd won my first league champions, you know, medal in my whole career. You know, after almost 10, 11 years of playing football, I finally got a league champion.
Well done to that. So you actually won a championship with Dynamo, so congratulations on that.
Yeah.
Then we were talking about the national team. When did you make your breakthrough to the national team?
Yeah, again, obviously after just joining Caps, one season at Caps, it was obviously in the late 90s. Ben Coffey was the coach at the time. My level of football at right back, you know, is improved. I was consistently having good games. So yeah, Ben Coffey called me up and gave me the chance. But the surprising thing is that I think Mercedes was injured at the time, and the right back was Angre Chapo.
Yeah.
So where did I have to play? Left back.
And you are not a natural left back.
Yes.
And you played left back for Zimbabwe.
Yes.
So the whole of Zimbabwe didn't have a natural left back to actually play there.
Unfortunately, at the time, yes, they didn't have, you know, I mean, the ones that were called up and were playing that well to play left back. They didn't. So I ended up playing left back under Ben Coffey. Yeah.
The utility man.
Yes.
Then after Ben Coffey, you graduated as well with Fabish. When Fabish came through, I think it was 1992. Then you came through. But before that, there's this match. Did you play the match at the National Sports Stadium where John Sibanda dropped that ball?
Unfortunately, I did. I actually played right back that game.
Take us through.
Yeah,
we hear stories about what happened in the changing rooms. We have always heard people tell us stories. We don't know. We were not there. So today you are here on In Touch. Now we want to know what happened with Armando Ferreira, with Peter Farnwell, with John Sibanda. Tell us the full story.
Obviously, it boils down to the dressing room saga where we had no clue. We all, because all the games prior to that day, the first choice was Peter Farnwell.
Yes.
You know, and we played a number of games, we had no problems, and then we went to the dressing that day, and for some reason, the coach decided to change, and when he named the team, he named John first.
Did you hear of any reason why he changed?
There was no reason given, you know, none of the players had done anything wrong, the training was up to standard, they both were doing well, even at their clubs and all that day. So, I don't know. Sometimes coaches choose, you know, to make a choice which ends up being the wrong choice, you know. It's how football is.
You were in the changing room. Then you saw this happening. You looked at the goalkeeper, obviously, Peter Farnwell.
Yeah.
Obviously, everybody would be like, wow, why is Peter Farnwell not on? How did Peter Farnwell take it?
Well, you know, it's difficult to say because, you know, when you're a player, sometimes you really, you can be disappointed, but you won't actually mention. You know, there's a lot of occasions where, you know, you're not picked in the first 11 and you know, as disappointed as you are, you know, and
you just you try to be a team player.
Yes, you try to be a team player, and because you have to accept it, you know, it's the coach's choice of the day, and that's how things go.
And John Sibanda, when you look at John Sibanda, was he okay? Was
he he looked all. All ripped up to go, you know, he was, you know, active as well, you know, throwing the ball against the wall, you know, what all goalkeepers do and some other thing. But I think from the onset, he was already, you know, nervous in the way he played. His distribution wasn't as normal, and, you know, and there's a few simple things that he was dropping, and it happened. But this is my own personal opinion. As much as John Sibanda made that one mistake where he let in the goal, we had numerous chances to score six.
Yeah.
Which we failed to do. You know, we had Peter and Moses were on fire that day. You know, we had chance after chance, whether the goalkeeper was saving it or whether we were just missing. You see, but we don't look at those mistakes. The goalkeeper makes one mistake and the team suffers.
So, yeah, it was gloom and doom for everybody. Yes. I was a young boy at that time. Yeah. I was at the stadium. I was watching. I was a big fan. Territory Tsangoma. Over there, we thought that we were going to the Nations Cup for the first time. So tell us about the changing room after now, after the game, when you went to the changing room. What was the situation?
You would have had a pen fall into that stadium, into that dressing room that day. It was silence. It was all, you know. Sadness. Usually we always go, you know, after a game, we usually go back to the hotel and, you know, have drinks and all that. I think that day, everybody just went back to the hotel, collected their bags and went home, you know, because it was disappointment. You know, once you think about it, you realize, you know, this kind of things happen in football. You know, it's a must chance for players to have the glory that you need in football. But you have to live with those things.
Armando Ferreira was the coach, and when he was going out of the stadium, he was pelted with everything that you can think of, the bottles, the mshimuguris, and do you think it was fair for the coach to be treated that same way when you were talking about missed chances, mistake?
Yeah, I know. You see, that's the problem with especially supporters, and I also, you know, read something, you know, not so long ago, a couple of weeks ago, about Zimbabwean supporters don't really rally behind the teams enough. You know, the minute the team goes behind a little bit, or they're not playing, you know, the entertainment football they really want, they are very quick to, you know, disappoint players by, you know, booing, and, you know, mistakes happen in football, or things happen in football where players don't play the way they normally can play. Mm-hmm. And instead of motivating, you know, if you look at, you will never ever go to the Zambian national team and hear the supporters, you know, bad how the team is playing.
Yes.
You know, they try to motivate by giving them things. But Zimbabweans seem to be too quick to want to, you know, boo the players, and or if they don't like a player that they think shouldn't be in the team, you know, they need to motivate the players more. As badly as they're playing, there's nothing worse than your own supporters, you know, discouraging you. You see, and as the national team, you know, there's, I mean, decisions are made. You know, Fabish was always badly insulted for not including Moses in the team, you know. But how can you insult him when he won games that we never used to win before, you know? And that's what football is about. It's obviously about the results, you see. And when you don't get a result, people tend to act in the wrong way, you know, and which is, you know, it's hard to accept as footballers.
Yeah, that was really bad. Even Sivas Chimenza once talked about it on his Facebook post, talking about the fans as well, that, you know, sometimes we blame the Football Association, the players and everybody, but one thing that we haven't blamed are the fans, because when we go out in Africa, we they hostile fans. They start from the airport, you know, they are very hostile to you at the stadium. Even if you are beating their team, they will never turn around and support you, never. But it only happens in Zimbabwe. Yes. So Kali, national team, tell us, what did you guys get up to in the national team in your days after the match? Let's say after the match, I'm talking about in Africa, when you travel in Africa after the match, what did you guys get up to?
We used to do a lot of things. Mainly, you know, just enjoy, you know, after game, you know. When we used to live here, you know, at the duty free shop used to have a lot of nice things at our local airport here.
Okay.
So we knew that, you know, our allowances weren't that good, and you know, money for things weren't that good outside of the country. So with our $10, we always make sure when we got into the duty free, we buy 2-3 bottles of, you know, the nice whiskeys and, you know, that kind of stuff there, you know.
We stock
up. But knowing that when you come back, you're only allowed to carry like one or two bottles, you see, but you buy three or four. So after game, you know, we go to the dressing room, we change up, then somebody just sends a message to the room, say, the party is in Stick's room.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we must make sure after you shower everybody, after we have dinner, everybody takes away two, three bottles. We into that one room, we have all 12 or 13 players that was drinking.
So footballers drink a lot?
Not a lot. I mean, yeah, they just enjoy when, you know, after football. Yeah, you know, we drink a lot because, I mean, like I said, our enjoyment life gets very
So it was just after the game, it was just in somebody's room, no going out, no going to the clubs and everything?
No. After, because you see, why we're saying is that, you know, most of the time we never got allowances and especially in terms of the countries we went to, we never got allowances in foreign currency. We only get allowances when you came back, you got your Zim dollars. You know, if you were out for the 4 or 5 days, when you came back, you got your allowance. When we were outside there, so to actually go to a nightclub and to enjoy that, it was quite difficult for us because
You needed the US dollar
or even the money of the countries we were in.
So you guys had it so hard because when we started playing for the national team, we used to get the foreign currency in the foreign country as well. So who were the naughty guys in the national team?
All of them. They were all naughty.
Okay, let's name the player that you played with in the national team.
Yeah. Oh, we start from the beginning. From when I first started, you know, they were all Sticks will be up front there with Senior, you know, with Brenner, you know, you get guys like Max, Makanza Lunga, but you know, those guys were all up to, you know, Ghetto and then even Shaky. Those are, you know.
Any pranks that they used to play on each other that you can remember?
It's difficult to say now. Some of them we can't talk about it, you know.
No.
Some of them we can't talk about it.
Guys, you see now, Kari doesn't want to tell us about the naughty things that they used to do
A lot of people are married and got children now, so we can't repeat those things.
Kari is just being diplomatic, guys. That's what we just say, guys, our time has run out. You know, we could have added some more time if Kari had decided to tell us what they used to get up to, but he didn't. So we are just going to call it a day, guys. Kari, thank you very much for coming on to the show. It was very much interesting, eye-opening as well. Thank you very much.
Thanks for having me, always. But we didn't have more time because, you know, there's still a lot of in football that we could have, you know, talked about and, you know, the joys of being with some of the players that you play with.
Yeah, but just before we go, just tell us a little bit, what are you doing now?
Well, in football,
we
have a program that we started. We actually called it Vision 2020, Arcadia Vision 2020.
Yes.
But due to the COVID thing, we are a bit behind now. We've tried to revamp Arcadia United.
Yes.
We've got a team in D2, which is comprises of obviously under 19s, under 20s. We are hoping by Vision 2020 at least to get back into D1. We're playing in D2 now. We missed promotion last year. Just towards the end of the season, we lost our points. But the name of the game is to revive Arcadia United. And, you know, with sponsorship coming in, all we're hoping to get them back into big flight football. I'm working with, obviously, with Charlie Jones, Sean Charters, and Simon Finch. And, we're getting help from, you know, guys from the diaspora. You know, they're helping to, you know, sponsor us a bit in terms of small caches. They always send us training equipment and all that. So, yeah, we're hoping to get back there.
Yeah, that is Arcadia United. It will be good to have Arcadia United back in the Premier Soccer League. Like I said, guys, we don't have much time. This has been an interesting show, proudly brought to you by DHMT Accounting Limited in the United Kingdom. For now, we are out of here. We will meet you again next week when we bring in another legend. But you can also tell us which legend you want us to bring next week. For now, we are out of here. We are in touch with the legend. Cheers.